pray, we want to seek his face. You ever experienced something like that? And I'm all by myself sometimes. I don't know. Nothing comes out. Nothing comes up. I don't know. But we come together and all of a sudden, I don't know, all of a sudden I want to pray. All of a sudden I'm able to have words in my mouth. All of a sudden I feel the presence of God. All of a sudden I want to be in his presence and I want to talk to him. Right? Oh, praise the Lord. It's a good night. It's a God night. It's a special night. Amen. You know, I'm going to start in the back row, and I'm going to say, Brother Mark, we usually don't have you on a Wednesday, so good to have our Brother Mark on Wednesday. And Sister Yvonne, I know you're busy. It's good to see you on a Wednesday. Hey. I want to talk about the Christmas play. I'm glad you're here. Two men of God, Stephen and Terry, we are so glad to be honored that you're here. Stephen, I've been thinking about you. We've been talking about you, so it's no mistake that you're here. And Terry, you're just an added bonus, man. We get double, right? The Lord gives us double for our trouble. That's good. That's good. Hallelujah. You know, I'm looking forward to the crosswalk. I think as we have gone along and made our preparation, I think excitement has built, you know, Pastor Edward. And you know, tell everybody, be a part of the crosswalk. You know, it's a great community thing. We have Lehigh Regional Hospital really involved with this one and really involved with this new group. So, you know, it's just nice to get more bodies involved with this. If you look at your notes and you look at the title of tonight is Unspeakable Joy. Unspeakable Joy. And it's under the subtopic. You've all got your sheets. The subtopic is Experiencing the Joy of Jesus. Experiencing the Joy of Jesus. But we're just starting on that subtopic today. And if you'll allow me, I will start by reading the fruits of the Spirit. I have to read them because sometimes I get confused when I recite the nine fruits of the Spirit. So the fruits of the Spirit, Scripture says that the fruit of the Spirit is, you know the first one?
Love.
Oh, hey, you're making me look bad reading. The fruit of the Spirit is love. Uh-huh. The next one says, it depends upon your translation too. The next one is joy, which we're talking about tonight. It is peace, patience, kindness. You can throw a couple of them out if you want. They're goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Scripture says, against such, what?
There is no law.
Hey, Michael. There is no law. Yeah. Yeah. This is the fruit of the Spirit. The Spirit is the Spirit of God. The unchangeable Spirit of God, his nature, he always possesses and always full of and is always part of his essence is joy. It's love. It's peace. It's goodness. It's kindness. Has nothing to do with life. Has nothing to do with what we see, what we experience, what we feel. It's who the unchangeable God is. The unchangeable God is love. That's why when we speak of unconditional love, nothing can change the love of God. It's unconditional. It's who he is. We can call it an emotion, but it's only like a piece of what it really is. What love really is, it's not an emotion. It's a spirit. It's the Spirit of God. It is unchangeable. Yeah. Unchangeable. The next one, what we're talking about tonight, is joy. The divine nature of God is joy. It is unchangeable. So the Spirit of God inside of you, the nature of you, because you are half human, you're only half human, by the way, and you're half divine, or you are both completely human and completely divine. So your nature, your essence is joy. It has nothing to do with what you experience, has nothing to do with where you go, has nothing to do with where you've come from. The Spirit of God is unchangeable, immutable, unstoppable, unshakable, right?
Right.
That's the joy we're talking about. We all have it. Not only do we have it, it's part of who we are. And not only that, look at the rest of them. These things are not things that you experience from time to time. I know most of us live our lives, and sometimes we experience love. Sometimes we experience joy. Sometimes you got some patience. Sometimes there's kindness. Sometimes there's goodness. Sometimes there's self-control. No, No. It's who you are. It's your essence. It might get covered up once in a while, but it's who you are. It's who you really are. So all you have to do is identify who you really are and live in the nature, your true nature. That's amazing to me. Amazing to me. So let's look at our first passage. Our first passage is the 16th Psalm. And the 16th Psalm is called a miktam. And a miktam, it's like one of David's golden psalms. It's one of his golden psalms because it talks about the death, the burial, the resurrection, and it doesn't end there. There's also the ascension of Jesus. And it's a good time to read that, being that this is Passion Week. Amen. So maybe we'll start the front row this time, Psalm 16, and somebody will follow us with the reading, Pastor Phil.
Psalm 16. Save me, O God, because I have come to you for refuge. I said to him, you are my Lord. I have no other help but yours.
As for the saints who are in the land, they are the glorious ones in whom is all my delight. Those choosing other gods shall all be filled with sorrow. I will not offer the sacrifices. I will not offer the sacrifices they do, or even speak the names of their gods.
Lord, you have assigned me my portion and my cup. You have made my lot secure. The boundary lies at home from me. Surely I have left it in darkness.
I will bless the Lord who counsels me. He gives me wisdom in the night. Tells me what to do. And I'm always thinking of the Lord, and because he is so near, I never need to stumble or to fall.
Heart, body, and soul are filled with joy, because you will not abandon me to the grave. Nor will you let your Holy One see decay. You have made known to me the path of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence. I can't see.
That's all right. Thank you, God.
With eternal pleasures at your right hand.
Thank you, Terry. With eternal pleasures at your right hand. Yeah. You know, when David wrote this psalm, it's been said that he was in a place where, you know, he was experienced some real hard times. Maybe he might have even been close to death because his enemies were all around him. You know, David's an interesting character in the Bible because it seems like his whole life he's encountering danger. If you read his story, if you read his Psalms, it's like his whole life, man, he had something he was coming up against. From a young boy facing Goliath. Everybody knows David and Goliath. David faced the giants in his life. See, the thing about David is he always confronted the giants of life, but he always conquered them. Yeah, he had many giants. Yeah, he had many fights, but he won them. And he never spoke about his life from the point of being a victor. He says, yeah, I fought bears. Yeah, I fought lions. Yeah, I fought giants. Yeah? Yeah, you want to know what happened? I beat them all. Sometimes we want to talk about how fierce the bear is and the lion. And oh, my. That's not how David talked about it. And even when he fought these beasts and these giants, it seemed as he fought them that he was close to death. It seemed like everyone betrayed him. Life itself betrayed him. God, at times, it seems, betrayed him. Has anyone ever felt as if God may have betrayed them? No, I love Jesus. No. Yeah. So although, David faced it all. He conquered it all. He said, God, I don't see you and I don't feel you, but I know you. But I know you. And I know your love and I know your goodness. And though it seems as if this is my last breath, he says, I'm going to give it to you, Lord. I'm going to give it to you. I'm going to give it to you in song. I'm going to give it to you in praise. I'm going to give it to you, Lord. And it seems like that at all of his last breaths, God was there. Every moment that seemed to be his last moment. How many moments of your life did you think that was it? Oh, this is it. This is a real winner here. Yeah, how many of them? Yeah. It's okay. It's okay. It's good. It's good, guys. Because, you know, even the song that was sang past, and we know the song, it said, Saul has slain his thousands, but David has slain his tens of thousands. You may have had more enemies in your life. It's only because God wanted to do a greater work in your life. He just wanted to make you stronger and better than the rest. You are honored by your enemies. I feel honored. Is that happy word? I feel honored, Father. There were many enemies. I feel honored. But wasn't it an honor to David? The songs that were sang about him, it was an honor that that mighty warrior has slain. Tens of thousands. Now, he didn't slay them all in a day. And in the battle, it seemed like sometimes he was winning and sometimes he was losing. Sometimes he acted like a madman. Sometimes he ran from his home. But in the end, he beat them all. Yeah. Yeah. And this psalm here, David's talking about, his death, if you will. He's talking about even his burial, but then he talks about how God has raised him back to life again, once again, raised him back to life, and not only that, but also brought him to an ascended place, because there's something greater than resurrection, and it's ascension. It's ascension. It's the completion of all that's ours. You see, the ascension isn't going to heaven one day, and God help us and change our minds that the ascension is one day. The ascension might be one day for us, but it has nothing to do with out there. The ascension, the end of it all, when you get to heaven, it's a place of glory. It's a place where God is. It's a place that was made available to you and I through the cross. And as Jesus hung upon the cross so many years ago, he told that thief 2,000 years ago, he said, you're going to be me in paradise today. Why? Because he was dying? No, because Jesus was dying. Because Jesus was dying. Yeah. You all just listening? Napping? I don't know what's going on. Thinking about it? Yeah. Okay. It goes on and it says this. You know, it's interesting to compare ourselves to David because it says, you know, even in verse 4, take a look at that. It says, those choosing other gods shall be filled with sorrow, and I will not offer the sacrifices they do or even speak the names of their gods. You know, in the midst of his woe, in the midst of his dismay, he says, I'm not going to speak as others speak and give glory to the other gods. I'm not going to give glory to fear and doubt and death and sickness and poverty. I know those words won't be a palm. I'm not going to give glory to those gods. We don't give glory to those gods, right? No. Those things aren't on our list, right? I'm afraid, I'm sick, I'm weak. No. David said, hey, it may look like I'm dying, but I ain't giving no credit to those gods. I ain't singing their praises. He says, I give my hope to God. I will praise my God in the midst of it all. This is our example to live by. Do not offer your lips and do not offer the sacrifice to other gods, these measly, weak, puny gods that we give so much power and we bow down to. We bow down to fear. We bow down to doubt. We bow down to hopelessness. Please, they're all the gods. Yeah. And we all say, oh, there's all the gods. That's right, there's no other gods. Give glory to his name. Yeah. Amen. And then look at 6. 6 says, the boundary lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. Surely I have delighted in. I have a delighted inheritance. We all think sometimes that our life, you know, sometimes it's wonderful, but sometimes it's not so wonderful. Can I get a witness? Yeah. And when our life is not so wonderful, we think we got the worst life of all. My life is terrible. I'm going through some circumstances right now. And David said this as they were killing him. He said, my lot has fell in pleasant places. This is my lot in life, and I will praise my God. Not everyone in this room experiences the same things. Doesn't experience the same woes, doesn't experience the same trials. Everybody has something in their life. Now you all should be shouting, hallelujah, yes, burning! Somebody acknowledges that. Everybody has something, and you think, oh, what's this curse that plagues me and my family? Everybody, God has chosen your lot for you. God has chosen your lot for you. He has chosen the enemies that you will conquer. He has said, you will get the Perizzites, you will get the Amorites, you will get the Hittites. Uh-huh. Which ones you got? Oh, I got the Perizzites. The Uptites, oh! You should conquer the Uptites in the name of the Lord. Everybody has an eye to conquer. And you might say, my eye is the fiercest of them all.
Well, yeah, I'm the only good one fighting.
God bless you. Go get them. I'm going to go get this eye. You get that eye. Occasionally we'll get together and get the eyes. But he has chosen your lot for you. Don't think your life is a mistake. Don't think that all hell is breaking out in your life. Don't think what's going on in my life. God chose the eye that you're going to conquer. He's going to conquer for you, for your family, and for the whole world. He has honored you with your enemies. Thank you. Thank you. He has honored you. He has perfectly selected the warriors. Not the warriors, no. The enemies that you will defeat. You will defeat them. Yours are different from others. Yes. Designed by God. And together, we're going to conquer them all. David says, my lot has fallen in pleasant places. And he has fought his enemies. And he has beat them all.
Amen.
Amen. I know we like to put labels on certain things and say, well, this is a despicable thing that I'm dealing with, that my family is dealing with, a shameful thing. It's just an item, and God did choose you to deal with that item. He chose that item for you to conquer. That's what David says. He says, I will bless the Lord who counsels me. It says he gives me wisdom in the night. Now, that can't be when you sleep at night, God speaks to you. I don't know, does God speak to you at night? Yeah, he's going to be. Does he ever wake you up? No, not me. He lets me sleep. You wake me up at night, but he lets me sleep. It says he will give you wisdom in the night, not physical night, when you're going through your dark season, when you're fighting your beasts, and it seems like you can't see the light of day. He says he'll give you wisdom in your night. He'll give you wisdom when you need it at the exact moment. He'll tell you what to do, what to say, how to do it. He will give you the wisdom of heaven to destroy the eye that he has selected for you.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah, because it is the work of God. It is not the work of any man. You and I have no power in ourselves to destroy these heights. But the wisdom of God, there's no help for them. There's no help for them. Know that. Know that you might not have an answer. It might be dark all around you. But know that you have the victory, and this thing is going down.
Amen.
And you might stay up at night and say, Lord, anything yet? Anything yet. Until the Lord speaks to you the wisdom at night. Do not offer your sacrifices to any other gods.
Amen.
Yeah. Yeah. And then verse 9, of course, he says, my heart, my body, and my soul is filled with what?
Joy.
I didn't hear you.
Joy.
Oh, my goodness. Joy. How is that even possible? Because it's not you, it's not me, it's the Spirit of God. He doesn't have joy, he is joy. It's part of your nature. You are joyful, it's who you are. It has nothing to do with anything. It's part of your DNA. DNA, what's that? DNA? I bet you there's something there. It's part of your DNA. Just take your scripture, Mr. Scientist. Yeah, that's right. Verse 10, it says, because he will not abandon you to the grave. You're in the grave, but you ain't staying in the grave. Some of you say, I'm in the grave right now. Some of you say, I just recently exited. Some of you say, whatever you say. But he will not leave you in the grave. He will not leave you in the grave. And he will not allow you to suffer decay or corruption. That will not be your demise. You will not remain there. You will rise up from your grave. You will rise up. And then he will lead you on the paths of life. He will pull you from your grave and from your hell. And as David always ends the psalm that says, he put my feet upon a path of life where one step in front of the other, you walking out of your grave. You're going to walk out of your grave, by the way. You're going to walk out of it one step by one step by one step. You're walking out of your grave. And it's the Spirit of God inside of you moving your feet. It ain't you, because you and I can't do it. The same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead is the one inside of you that puts one foot in front of the other, that gives you joy, that gives you peace, that gives you confidence. It's the Spirit of God that causes you to walk from that grave one step at a time. One step at a time. Now, you might need to step slowly or fast. I don't know. I'm just getting out. And it says, you fill me with joy in your presence, with eternal pleasures at your right hand. This is being spoken from a man who says, there's death all around me, however, I will not offer my sacrifice to any false gods. Don't you just love that? I will not praise any false gods. I love that. I will not praise fear. I will not praise death. I will not praise weakness. I will not praise infirmity and poverty. I will not offer my lips to that thing, but only to the true living God. So, how do we live with joy? How do we live with joy? The Spirit will also teach us. Great expectations is our subtopic. Great expectations. Would somebody read Hebrews 12:2 for us? Anybody in the room?
Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God.
Perfect. Thank you, Terry. Jesus is our example. Always look unto Jesus, because he's the author and the finisher of our faith. It says concerning Jesus, for the joy that was set before him. See, joy always has great expectations. Joy always believes in a future. Always believes that the best is going to happen. Always believes. Always hopes. Joy has great expectation. You know, we expect good things over the events of our lives, over the things coming up, over the things we experience. Joy. Causes us to look into the future with hope and anticipation, and maybe, just maybe, once in a while, get a little excited. Now, I don't know, anybody there? Don't tell me we're all not excited about life, anybody? Yeah! Don't tell me you don't have it, it's who you are. You can lie to me and say you ain't got it, it's just a lie. Don't offer the fruit of your lips. Don't be serving other gods and tell me you ain't got joy. You're worshiping another god. You have joy. Okay. So, you see, yeah, you do have to endure a cross, though. Yeah, you got to endure a cross, sure. But the only way you're going to get through your valleys, the only way you get through your death is to have a joy in front of you. It's not to expect death at the end of it all. It's to expect life at the end of it all. Yeah, I'm going to get through this, but there's life in front of me. There's joy in front of me. There's peace in front of me. There's strength in front of me. If you're not experiencing, if you're experiencing a cross right now, it's the hope of the better future, expecting great things. Expect great things in your life. Somebody read Psalms here for us, Psalms 30.
O Lord, you brought my soul up from the grave. You have kept me alive, that I should not go down to the pit. Sing praise to the Lord, you saints of his, and give thanks at the remembrance of his holy name. For his anger is but for a moment, his favor is for life. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning.
Promise to hold on to. We all have our nights of weeping, right? Now, night is just one night. It's just a season. It's a season. We have our nights of weeping. But the promise is, what is the promise, Michael? The joy.
Joy comes in the morning.
Joy comes in the morning. You see, joy expects great things. My goodness. It says that the things that we experience in a negative way, they're passing, they're fleeting, they're but for a moment, but the life of God is eternal. Is eternal. Man, we need to know God and have an understanding of eternity. When we have an understanding of eternity, we give no credit to these things that afflict us in just a moment. It's just a moment.
and we have the patience to endure because we know that they fade and they pass. And after, come on now, you've all fought a couple of warriors in your life. You know that these things in your life, they go, right?
Amen.
You know the bad times go, right? You know your enemies fall, right? Can I get a better witness than that?
Yes.
You know they fall, right? Yeah. So then every time we encounter something else, we're not dismayed. We just, anything that comes our way, you're going to fall like the rest of them. The Goliaths that come in front of us, I'll knock down a few, and I say to Goliath, you're going down too.
Amen.
You're going down.
Yes.
That's right.
Praise the Lord.
That's right. And we're not afraid of process because God works in the process of it all. Listen, there are times of afflictions in our life that are not pleasant. But you know, my goodness, after a while, the Spirit of God rises up inside of you and you start to like embrace the process. And you say, the process is good, it ain't bad. Don't be afraid of the process. Don't be afraid of what God's doing in these moments. Hey, man, expect some stuff, man. It's okay. You ever live life like that sometimes? You're going through some tough stuff. Hey, it might get worse before it gets better, right? Yeah. It might get worse before it gets better, but we're going to win. Don't be afraid of the moments that don't seem to be going so well. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. Relax. And look at life, not as a skeptic, not as a critic, not as a pessimist. Ain't no joy in that. You gotta look at life as the optimist, as the believer. Believe in the best.
Yeah.
Don't expect things to fail. And don't expect people to fail. That's living as the pessimist, the skeptic. Don't expect people to fail. There's no joy. Because you know why? That takes your joy from you.
Yeah.
It's a thief that steals your joy. When you expect people around you to be idiots, that steals your joy, your strength, your life. Foolish woman tears down her own house. I tear you down, I'm tearing myself down.
That's right.
Foolish woman does that. Our souls, foolish. It's foolish for me to speak poorly of you. It's foolish for me not to believe in the best in you. It's foolish for me not to say you're gonna win and you're gonna win like a champion. It's foolish of us to think any other way. No matter what anyone goes on in life or what they experience, you look into their eyes and you look into their life and you believe in them and you believe in yourself and you say, you're going to succeed. Because that brings you joy. Hope brings you joy. Brings you joy. Whatever the negative is, say it's going to fall. And that's how you live in that joy. Amen?
Amen.
Delight thyself. Look at Roman numeral number 2 there. Delight thyself. Sometimes you gotta delight yourself, you know? You know, I don't see no delight anywhere around me. It's inside. Delight yourself. Just sit in your room and just start laughing. Okay, that's silly. But delight yourself. Somebody read that first Psalm for us.
Be delighted with the Lord, and he will give you all your heart's desires.
Perfect point, thank you. It says, you delight yourself in the Lord. You delight yourself in the Lord. I believe this is the answer. This is what brings joy into our life. What brings joy into our life is this. Let nothing in life give you more joy than God. Let nothing in life give you more joy than the things of God. You know, there are things in life that we get joy out of, and there's nothing wrong with getting joy out of so many things in life, right? But you see, Scripture says to delight yourself in the Lord. The greatest delight, if you, and it says you can do this now, you can do this, you can make sure that the greatest delight is in the Lord. The greatest delight you have is to talk to God. The greatest delight you have is to say, God, I love you. God, I know you here. God, I feel you. God, me and you. Me and you, Lord. Me and you. Delight yourself in the Lord above every other relationship. Know how special your relationship is with God. You know how beautiful and how powerful it is. You take delight in that. Every time you wake up in the morning, every time you walk through the day, whether you think there's a million people around you, you think you're all by yourself, the greatest relationship you have is with God. You're always with God, and God's always with you. He's always loving you. He's always enjoying the moments with you. He's always laughing with you. He's always going through you with your help with you, but he's always with you, and he's your greatest friend. He's your greatest friend. He's your greatest savior. He is the greatest relationship in your life. Value it above every other relationship. To delight yourself in the Lord. I take delight that God is my closest friend. Isn't he yours?
Amen.
He's your closest friend. He is the one that always hears you. He always hears you. He knows why you shed your tears, and he knows why you have a smile on your face. The Lord knows. He's the one. He's the one working in your life. Delight yourself in that. Then, Lord, don't let anything steal it from you. Don't let say, Lord, I've done this and I've done that. Those are thieves and liars. Don't let anything steal that delight from you. Jesus paid a price to give it to you. Don't let any liar come and take it. Oh, you did this and you did that. I know, but Jesus took care of that. Nothing can separate you from the love of Christ. The love of God in Christ Jesus. Nothing. Nothing. Death, nor life, angels, nor demons. I don't care if you're acting like a devil today. It's not going to separate you from the love of God. How do you like that one? Okay, somebody read Isaiah.
Then the Lord will be your delight. God will see to it that you ride high and get your full share of the blessings. I promise to Jacob, your father, the Lord has spoken.
Not. Perfect. Okay, so then the Lord will be your delight. When you let the Lord be your delight, it says then you're going to ride on high. You're going to have your full share of blessings. Delight. Take pleasure in your relationship with your Savior, with your Lord. You know, the nice thing about that is he always loves you. He's never angry at you. He's always on your side. It's good to have a friend like that, right?
Yeah.
No matter how wrong you are, and my brother Rich has been wrong so many times, but the Lord has never forsaken him. I have forsaken him, but the Lord has been his best friend. Right, Rich? Yeah. Always believes in you. Huh. Man, take delight in that. Man, that'll give you joy. God's for you. Who cares who rejects you? God's for you. Oh, man. All right, Psalm 16, somebody read that one again. Psalm 16, 3.
As for the saints who are in the land, they are the glorious ones whom is all my delight.
Beautiful. This one is good, everybody. It's really good. As for the saints who are in the land, who are the saints? Whoever you see is the saint, okay? We're all saints. Jesus paid the price. You're not a saint based upon your work. You three miracles, we love you a saint. Listen, man, listen. It's a miracle you're up and walking, you're a saint. It's a miracle you're here on a Wednesday. That's two miracles. Maybe the third miracle. It's a miracle you're laughing at it all. Three miracles. You love you saints. Three confirmed miracles. You're a saint. You paid the price. What can you do? What can you pay for? Okay, so a saint's anyone who sees the saint. But it says this, when you delight yourself, this is what's going to bring you joy in your life. It says, not only do you delight yourself in God, but I think this is to be equally important as delighting yourself in God, because sometimes it's easy to delight ourselves in God, because he's invisible and he always loves us, and I don't really have to, you know, deal with, you know, a lot of things when I deal with God. Like you. He says, delight yourself in the saints. We need to live our lives delighting ourselves in each other. All too often in life, we don't delight in each other. Or we only have a handful of certain folks. You know, I delight myself in you. That's not true.
I'm good, yeah.
It says, delight yourself in the saints. If you will find delight in people all around you, you will have joy. And what steals your joy is when you don't delight in everybody around you. When you don't delight in your neighbors and your friends and your family and anyone who walks through the streets, anybody in your job, anybody in your house. You want joy? Delight in the people around you. Take delight in them. It's a thief that causes you not to delight in them and steals your joy. Anyone experience stuff like that? I'm not happy with you and I'm just not happy. But when you delight yourself in God, God is never about, you know, the invisible. He's still like, he says, listen, man, you know God's all around you. Our life, it will be so much easier if we found delight in our time with each other, in our interactions, if we value our friendships and the conversations that we have. Isn't it beautiful, guys? Isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
You know, even to sit here on a Wednesday and to interact with one another, you know, doesn't that just something that's invisible, that's spiritual, that satisfies, that pleases, right?
Mm-hmm.
Brings joy, you know? I look into your faces, Terry and Stephan, and it's a delight. It's a delight. It's powerful too, isn't it? Yeah. Yeah, this is joy. Oh man, look at the world and find the joy and the delight in it. Delight yourself. Delight yourself. Don't let anybody steal that from you or anything. And then of course, pure joy at the end of it all. Somebody read that passage, 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 6 through 9.
So be truly glad. There is a wonderful joy ahead, even though the going is rough for a while down here. These trials are not only to test your faith to see whether or not it is strong and pure. It is being tested as fire tests gold and purifies it, and your faith is far more precious to God than mere gold. So if your faith remains strong after being tried to the test tube of the fiery trials, it will bring you much praise and glory and honor on the day of his return. You love him even though you have never seen him. Though not seeing him, you trust him. And even now you are happy with the inexpressible joy that comes from heaven itself. And your further reward is for trusting him will be the salvation of your souls.
Yeah. Scripture tells us this pure joy, it's part of your makeup, it's part of your nature, it's part of your essence, is pure joy. And sometimes the fire burns away everything, it's going to burn away all these things that says, oh, this thing took my joy and that thing took my joy. And then when all those things get burned away, you realize who you really are, the Spirit of God that dwells inside you. Nothing ever took your joy, it's impossible. It's a discovery of who you are. You are, my goodness, you are unshakable, you are unstoppable, you are untouchable. There's nothing that this world could ever do to you to touch you. You are untouchable. The Spirit of God that dwells inside you, and let the fire burn away all the lies, and let there be a discovery of just how indestructible you are, the holy, incorruptible seed of God that dwells inside of you. You are so sealed, you are so, so pure. And through it all, we will have a realization of this, but we'll finally come to an understanding that nothing in this life can touch us. Oh my goodness, how did we ever think that we were all about getting through this life and what this life is doing to us? My goodness, you don't know who you are. You have no idea who you are. God puts you in this world to go touch the world, to change the world. He puts you in the world to conquer and take dominion. This life ain't happening to you. You're happening to life. We call and tell each other about all these things going on in our life. I know. That's why you're here. We're here to destroy everything, all the ice in life. We're here to conquer and take dominion. It's who we are. And we are indestructible, man. There's no hope for anything else around us. There's no hope. Nothing can stand against us. That's why we're here. Oh my goodness. And these fires and these trials will burn away all these lies and facades. And my goodness, life ain't happening to us. Life is not happening to us. We are the ones put upon the earth to change the world. And therefore, everything about us, the Spirit of God inside of us, who we are, we are immutable, unchangeable. That joy, that peace, that love, it's immutable, it's unchangeable. Nothing can quench it, nothing can dull it, nothing can make it greater or lesser. It's constantly fervent inside of you.
Yes.
Nothing can diminish the capacities of the Spirit of God inside of you. Nothing. I think the Spirit of God only gets better. By no means does it ever get smaller. If we only knew who we were. If we only knew who we were. And this is why these things come into our life, so that it says, for a while these things happen to you down here. Until what? Down here? Down where? Down in this lonely place. Down where? Where's down here? You know where down here is. Down here is the grave. And it ain't no physical grave, therefore heaven is no physical heaven. The grave and hell is what you experience right now. And it says, up from the grave he arose with a mighty triumph. They'll pull you from your grave, and you're going to start to walk in heaven. And then there's an ascended life, because there's death, there's burial. Yeah, there's resurrection, but there's not the just resurrection. There's the ascended life. The ascended life isn't going to live in heaven, man. It's not going to live in heaven, but it's going to live in heaven. It's going to live in heaven.
Yeah.
It's going to live in heaven. Jesus could not be more clear, but we have to say it a billion times until we have the revelation of it. The kingdom of heaven is here. It's all around you. It's inside you. It's invite. Oh, not really, though. But not really.
Oh, yes, really.
Oh. Well, I'm waiting to go to heaven. When I die, I'm going to go to heaven. The ascended life is realizing who you are. It's realizing the life of God. The ascended place is you coming up from your muck and your mire and your grave and your hell. Don't tell me that's not heaven when God raises you up from an earth throne and causes you to live in the heavens where nothing on earth affects you, but you affect everything upon the earth. That's living in the heavens. The heavens happens to the earth.
Amen.
That's living in the ascended place where you change the earth. You can water it, you can cloud it, you can sun it, do whatever you want to do to it. You're the heavens. You want to spread some sunshine? Spread some sunshine. It's up to you, you know. You know you can do it if you want to do it. Yeah. Sure you can. You can walk into a room, spread sunshine. You can get hell. Your choice.
Yeah.
We prefer the sunshine. You can go into a room and you can rain all of the glories of heaven on folks if you want. Yeah, you are the heavens. You have the capacity to live the ascended life and change the earth based upon the heavens that you are. You can rain down, you can rain down.
Oh, I'm going to rain down, all right. I'm going to rain down. Rain down the wrath. Wrath, not the wrath of God, the wrath of man will rain down. Mm-hmm.
He says, rise up to the ascended place where you stop telling everyone about what the earth is doing to you, and you ascend. You must ascend. You can live a resurrected life upon the earth, but then the earth is always affecting you. It's always affecting you. It's always affecting you. Oh, finally, you have to be ascended to the heavenly realm where the earth no longer affects you, but you're the one who affects the earth.
Yes.
You go into every situation, every circumstance of life, and the heavens causes the earth to change. Oh, yeah. Until the two become one, until there's a new heaven and a new earth, it's the merging of the heaven and earth together, the divine and human, and it's like, you know, it's like heaven on earth, kind of, you know? Like the new Jerusalem coming down from heaven and coming down upon the earth kind of a thing. When does that happen? I've seen it happen before. I'll see it happen again. I'm looking at some of it right now. It's very beautiful. Can I get a witness?
Amen.
Joy is immutable. It is constant. It is unchangeable. It's who you are. It's who you are. Why don't we all stand? Praise the Lord. Close the word of prayer. My Lord, we do thank you for the night. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your joy. We thank you for your peace and your long suffering and your gentleness, your goodness, your kindness. That's who we are. We pray, Lord. We pray for the ascended life. We pray that we would live as, my Lord God, the one who changes the earth around us, knowing who we are in Christ Jesus, a price that was paid for in full so long ago. And that's what we commemorate this week, what you have given and done for us so long ago. So in the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and everybody says,
Amen.
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 Amen. Amen. God bless you all.
Amen.
Obviously.